Tonight, we'll be regaling you with remarkable research regarding animals, starting with the letter R. We'll be doing it with these magnificent beasts, our rollicking rockfish, Maggie Aderin-Pocock. A roguish Rottweiler, Ed Gamble. A ravenous raven, Tom Allen. And Roger My Rabbit, Alan Davis. Right. Let's hear their beastly buzzers. Maggie goes.
You bet.
Yeah, that's very good. Ed goes.
Fair enough.
Yeah. Tom.
That's what's happening inside my head all the time.
Alan goes. What animal do you reckon it was?
It sounds like a blue whale, surely.
I mean, what kind of boy doesn't know his blue whale from his humpback?
Oh, a humpback. Oh.
Right, now, today's show, all about animals, but Maggie, you work on the sky at night, you're a scientist, you're always looking up into space. What animal can you see here? If I show you this picture... There are people in the world, mostly Japan, China, other Far Eastern countries.
Rabbit?
It is. It is a rabbit. I can't see it myself. Tom, are you seeing rabbit?
I feel like it's when somebody shows you their baby scan.
Yes.
And you go like, oh yeah, wow, it looks just like you. It's like, just looks like that. Yeah. No, I can't see anything.
Sometimes even when the baby's been born, you think, no, I'm still
just,
not.
What's that?
A rabbit. It's like a turnip. I don't see it, but we can superimpose,
superimpose
the thing on the top of it. And then... See,
yeah,
I mean...
What?
No. That, even that doesn't look like a rabbit.
It looks like a sorrowful rabbit. It looks like the rabbit's going, oh, I'm on the moon. I have no friends.
It's like a map of the UK in a high wind.
It looks like a rabbit trying to do a magic trick where it pulls a smaller rabbit out of a hat.
Yes. apparently, it's meant to be a mortar and pestle, and it's grinding, I don't know, herbs for the gods. In some stories, the rabbit is a companion of the goddess of the moon, who's called Chang'e, the Chinese goddess of the moon. She floated up to the moon after drinking too much elixir of immortality.
People who peddle these things, I think they ever run out of steam. She floated up to the mid... Oh, doesn't matter.
Yeah. She was married to a celebrated archer who was called Hu Yi, and it was too hot. There were 10 suns in the sky, and he shot 9 of them out of the sky, so then we only had one left. And the goddess in charge was so thrilled with this that she gave him the elixir of immortality, but only enough for one. So he thought, I'm not leaving my wife, that's not nice. So he put it under the bed, she drank it. Yeah, what? I know, it's not a happy marriage story, not really.
They couldn't split it.
Well, anyway, she floated off to the moon because he was so cross with her.
Oh,
that's been a downer, that story. Okay. Well,
what do they think the moon is? Yeah. I mean, does she think you get up there and it's like sort of a Four Seasons hotel or something?
Well, it's a really good question. What do you think the moon is? Because the Samoan people believe that there was a girl called Sina, and she was a beautiful girl who thought that the moon was made of breadfruit, and there was a terrible famine, and so she asked the moon to come and feed her. The moon was annoyed, so it kidnapped Sina into the sky, and so she lives in the moon.
It's crowded up there, isn't it?
Everybody
living up there.
So she thought the moon was breadfruit.
Yes, she did.
So she asked the breadfruit to come to her so she could eat the breadfruit, and then the breadfruit kidnapped her because it was annoyed.
Hey, breadfruit, yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come down. Yeah, sure, OK. Yeah.
Now you're coming with me.
Yeah, exactly. It's not a good story.
When I hear about planets with more than one moon, I'm quite envious. Like, Jupiter's got several moons.
Well, well over 60. And we've
well over
more.
60?
Oh, yeah. The outer planets tend to sort of be... They're bigger and they sort of more gravity and stuff like that. But you see, our moon is the best moon.
Why?
compared with Earth, our moon is very big, and so it helps protect us. So asteroids, meteorites, things like that, the moon will take some of those knocks. You can see it on the craters. So the moon takes some of the knocks for us.
Like a bouncer.
Yeah, that's it. I'll take that. Move on.
If the Earth and the moon perhaps were formed at a similar time, and the Earth is in the Goldilocks zone with the water and the environment and the atmosphere, yeah. And so it is the Moon, but the Moon, nothing.
No, a really harsh environment. But the Moon's so much smaller. If you talk the surface area of the Moon, it's about slightly smaller than the surface area of Asia. So it's quite small in comparison. And also, being small, it's got lots less gravity. And so, if it did ever have an atmosphere, it's long gone.
So it's the size and the lack of gravity that stops it forming an atmosphere.
Yeah. Also, as a result, it means the sun's rays blast it really hard. And so, for instance, temperature on the Moon goes from minus 150 to plus 150. So
I had a boiler like that once.
You can't get it right. There's nothing in the middle.
So tell me something, we're delving into your knowledge here. Ooh, if there was an actual rabbit on the Moon,
yes,
would we have been able to detect it in theory if we had had the Planck spacecraft?
Yes.
Am I right that they were able to detect variations in temperature?
Yes.
To like a millionth of a degree?
Yes.
So you could, through temperature, have picked up a rabbit on the Moon?
Yes, but assuming a rabbit could survive on the Moon and maintain its temperature, then it could have picked it up.
Right.
I'm getting so carried away.
I'm quite interested. Generally on this show, we know nothing, so this is a very exciting move into actual facts.
At the moment, this feels like the morning of a science exam and Maggie's the only child who's done any of it.
There may be some actual animals living on the Moon. That is a possibility. So in 2019, an Israeli spacecraft crash-landed on the Moon.
Oh.
The payload contained tardigrades. Do you know about tardigrades?
Yeah, water bears.
Yes.
Oh. Very, very robust. They were encapsulated, I think, in amber. But they can hibernate for sort of decades at a time. And they can experience sort of very cold temperatures. So they could survive. They could bring them back to Earth and see if they sort of wake up.
They're amazing. They're micro animals. Do you not think they're extraordinary? I think they're kind of cute, actually.
No, it's horrible. It's like some horrible alien dick pic.
Let's Google that. Horrible alien dick pic. See what comes up.
But they were desiccated, the ones that land on the Moon.
Presumably like
they...
coconut?
Yes, darling, exactly like coconut. But I don't know.
Chewy, but
delicious.
If you drop them in water, whether they'd come back to life. I don't know enough about...
Tom, this is not Bake Off.
Right, how might small pants affect your sex life?
My.
Any thoughts?
I'm very much enjoying the dungaree version on the far left. I don't know quite what he's going to put in that pocket. Yeah. What's going to go in there? But imagine if a painter decorator turned up dressed in that, you'd be like, oh no, you're not taking this seriously at all.
I don't think you would be either. No. I have a little prop here to see if this assists you. So I'm talking about very, very small pants, okay? These are polyester underpants, and they have been used to. Not these particular ones, obviously, but pants this size used examining the sex life.
You're not asking how it would affect my sex life?
Yes, it would. It might.
What, those might?
Well, not
well I'd
these.
Imagine it would completely destroy it.
This is a pair of tiny trousers, a little bit like the ones that were used by an Egyptian urologist called Ahmed Shafik. And he wanted to study the impact of various textile materials on the sex life of rats. OK. Why might he think that this was a good idea?
Funding?
Rats are quite similar to humans, well, in some ways. We often use them... Well, we... I don't know.
No.
they have been used, yes.
That's absolutely right. So they had different groups of male rats, and some of them had tiny pants made of wool, some had cotton, some had polyester. Some had a polyester-cotton mix, which I don't approve of.
Oh, no, that sounds very sweaty. Yes. Yeah, I don't like that.
And then there was a control group who were obviously commando, clearly.
Of course,
clearly the commando rats.
Letting it out there.
Yeah. And I don't know if I can say it on here, but they had little openings made for the anus and for the penis and for the tail.
You've said it. You just said it straight out.
I know. Did it sound all right?
Yeah, it sounded fine. You really ran with it.
Yeah,
you're just saying it with a pair of tweezers in your hand.
I know. I was trying to touch it.
I've got a picture of a rat wearing those.
No, unfortunately, we don't. Samuel Whiskers is the best that we could do wearing a pair of pants. Anyway, the rats were selected based on their high potency, OK? I know. And so they had their sexual activity...
They fill in a form. high potency?
Yes, that's me. So they had their sexual activity checked four times. So it was once before the study, then once after 6 months of wearing the pants, whichever...
6 months of wearing the pants?
And then once after 12 months of wearing the pants.
12 months?
And then finally it's 6 months after the pants have been removed. So these are the four times that they checked.
A year of wearing the same pants. What were they, students?
So here's the bit of the graph that I don't care for. It's the insertion to mount ratio. So the control group and the wool group and the cotton group, it didn't seem to make any bloody difference to them at all. Their sex lives seemed to be exactly the same.
They don't have to take their pants off. They're ready to go.
No, because there's a hole. Yeah. I tried to show you.
A hole, yeah.
There's a little...
Don't make her do it again. No, no, no. It's very unpleasant.
If their partner's got the tweezers, they're all right.
Yes, exactly.
How do the pants with the hole in the front and the back for the tail relate to human trousers? Because I've only got 2 to 3 pairs of trousers with a hole in the front and the back.
No, so what I'm saying is the wool was fine, the cotton was fine, the commando, they were all fine. It's the polyester and polyester mix pants. So they showed an increase in attempted mounts but a decrease in successful insertion.
Is it because they just slid right off?
Well,
was the other rat wearing polyester as well?
Terrible friction.
Yeah, there was a...
Does anybody remember nylon sheets? That was a very bad idea. You got into bed and slid out the other side.
If you put it in the dark, you could stroke them and then spark up.
Spark up. Really?
Yeah, it's like a light show.
So, darling, this is some of the issues with these polyester pants, right? Is that it generated electrostatic charges in the scrotal area. Do you see how I'm saying all these things?
Everything about that is so sexy.
Yeah.
When you say things like that, Sandy, I don't know if they'll be able to broadcast this.
You're very good.
Electrostatic charges in the scrotal area. I'm just committing it to memory.
I'll use that one.
I've never seen a pornographic film. Do they have voiceover? Because I could do the voiceover.
I think they don't have voiceover. I wish they did have voiceover.
Do you think it's like a David Attenborough nature doctor?
And here we have the plumber.
No, that's not the tool I thought he meant at all.
Surely there's audio description.
Pornography for the visually impaired.
It's possible that this electrostatic field, I'm trying to be serious about it, is responsible for reduced sexual success. That is the possibility.
Well, it would put you off, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Why? Sparks coming off it. I think I'd probably say,
okay,
actually,
you know.
Let's just have
another time.
So
anyway, don't wear them. I think that's fundamentally what we're saying.
Or do wear them. Yeah. If you're electric shock in your balls.
Anyway, moving on. What is powdered rhino horn used for in traditional Chinese medicine?
I'm going for it.
Yes.
Aphrodisiac. I know.
Yeah, that's obviously what we're all thinking.
Yeah.
But I'm always thinking that with everything.
Oh, yeah.
Aphrodisiac. That could be an aphrodisiac. Give that a go.
In official Chinese traditional medicine, rhino horn, or zi zhao, has never been prescribed as a sexual stimulant. It's a myth, which the Western media seems happy to run with, and it's not true at all. Most often seems to be prescribed for fever. But there's a whole list of things that you might suggest.
I imagine the horn, if it wasn't powdered, I imagine the horn could be quite a sexual stimulant.
What, so you could just literally say, I've got the horn?
Yeah. is that where that comes from?
Here it is.
Got the horn. No.
In these socially distanced times, it might be better.
Yeah.
Oh.
Here's a rhino horn.
What are you doing there, Harry Potter? What are you doing?
I've got
the proms.
I haven't got the point yet. The pointy end's pointing out. I want you and I'm...
Tempting a woman.
Yeah, I'm being tempted. It doesn't have to be a woman. Could be a rhino.
I don't think a rhino would be tempted by the disembodied horn of its friend.
That's Uncle Albus!
There's a rhino over there. They come over and then they think, well, actually, now I'm here.
Have a look at all these diseases that in traditional Chinese medicine they reckon you can cure with some rhino horn, of which my favourite, I think, is the evil miasma of hill streams.
When you get it, it's...
That's very bad. Well, the rectal bleeding.
Well, you would get that with a rhino.
Yeah.
China isn't the only culture to attribute special properties to the rhino horn, so the Greeks believe that you could detect poisons if you drank because it would produce bubbles or by the horn changing colour. So there may be something in the poison detection thing, because rhino horn is mostly made of keratin and it chemically reacts with strong alkaline solutions, which many poisons are.
But it's a nonsense, isn't it, the medicinal thing?
Yeah, I mean, they did a study in 1990 at the Hong Kong University and they used very large doses of rhino horn, and it very slightly lowered fever in them. But not worth it, I think, to kill a rhino to get a rat to feel a tiny bit better.
The trade-off is not good.
Just take its pants off, it'll be fine.
Call me an animal rights mad person. I think that's
put some cotton briefs on.
You'll be right as right.
But the reason that they come to a point is that the outer keratin is softened by the sun, and then it's worn away when they clash horns or rub and so on, and the solid core remains. And if their horns were hard all the way through, then it would have a cylindrical... Paul, it wouldn't be shaped in any way.
If they looked after it, they could have like a Coke can.
I know, it's a
flat top.
Yeah.
Most just back them... off, I'm growing this.
Yeah,
I don't want one of those pointy ones. I don't want a stumpy one.
Well, there are some that have a different shape to it, because most of them tend to grow in that shape, and that's because the keratin in the front grows faster than the keratin in the back. But you do see the occasional rhino with a forward curving horn. And this one just looks depressed, doesn't it?
It's always
like... Yeah, it's like he had a normal horn and then he went,
Right. Which part of a racehorse anatomy needs to be really big if it's going to win?
His nose. A long nose is going to get you there first.
Yeah.
Right? Which depends how long, right?
Yeah, but a head by a nose. A
couple of feet.
Yeah. Just the whole length of the track and just going... Yeah.
I don't think this one's a winner, particularly.
No. You can read, though. So.
Yeah. What's the feature that's most directly linked to success on the track?
Oh, is it... It'll be testicles or something again, won't it?
Yeah, that wouldn't work at all.
If you had big testicles, that would be like bongos going down the track.
Yeah.
It would be like that executive toy, wouldn't it?
Yeah, too. And the jockey gets relaxed.
Yes. Yes, or if they swing up on the head. I mean, none of it's... No, darling, not testicles.
It's not that. OK, fine.
Anybody else? Anyone?
Lungs, sort of capacity.
Oh. It is sort of to do with lungs.
Brain. So it can outfox the rest of the competitors.
Takes a shortcut. Yeah.
It is to do with the size of the heart. Oh. So the way that gamblers used to predict... Do you follow the horses at all? Do you ever bet on the horses?
Your name's Dan, that's why she's not.
Yes.
I was quite accusatory for a second. Do you follow horses?
No, sorry.
Just leave them alone.
Well, I love a bit of a gamble. But I don't know anything about it. But it used to be whether the horse was from good stock, so whether the parents or the siblings had won lots and lots of races. But in fact, they did some analysis. There's a man called Jeff Sedder. He's a racehorse analyst. So he collected lots of data from young racehorses and about how many races they had won. And the size of the left ventricle was the most telling physical trait. So the left ventricle is obviously the bit that pumps oxygen back out into the body, right? Right ventricle puts it into the lungs, but then pops it out into the body. And the size was the most critical thing. So he examined them all using ultrasound, not surgery, because that would be...
This one was great.
He would have been really fast. And it led him to predict the greatness of a horse called American Pharaoh. It was an extraordinary horse. Went on to win the 2015 Triple Crown, which is a sort of grand slam of racehorsing success. So this is American Pharaoh. And there was also a famous racehorse called Far Lap. He was a sort of national celebrity in Australia during the Great Depression. And it was discovered he had a heart that was twice the size of an average horse. In fact, that heart is now displayed in the National Museum of Australia. I do hope they have other things as well. The most successful racehorses are the ones with the biggest hearts. When the ravens leave the Tower of London, where do they go?
They're not allowed to leave,
something,
are they?
You know, the throne of the monarchy, or I think something horrible happened.
Well, it's a myth. So the notion is that they've consistently lived at the Tower since the reign of Charles II, and that he was warned the crown would fall if the ravens ever left. In fact, the earliest record that we can find of ravens at the Tower only goes back as far as 1895. And probably it was to do with the sort of raven craze that followed Edgar Allan Poe's famous poem in the 1850s. And we can't find any evidence of them being further back than that. So usually there are six ravens, right, in the Tower, and they get raw meat and dead mice. Special treat, biscuits soaked in blood. Anybody? There was one called George who was a repeat offender. And in 1981, he disappeared but was recaptured at the local pub and made to return to duty. But his bad behaviour continued. And eventually he was retired. The Tower announced on Saturday, the 13th of September, 1986, Raven George, enlisted 1975, was posted to the Welsh Mountain Zoo. Conduct unsatisfactory.
they posted him. died in the envelope on the way there.
But he's not the only raven to have gone AWOL. There are wonderful stories which Christopher Scaife, the current Raven Master of the Tower, recounts in his book The Raven Master, My Life with the Ravens at the Tower of London, and he talks about how Raven Moonin escaped in 2010, but you don't need me to tell you about that because he is here himself. Raven Master, welcome to the show. Thank you so much for coming. Tell me about Moonin's escape. What happened?
I was a little bit worse for wear one morning when I was getting the ravens up, and it was at a time when I was going through some minimum wing trimming, and Moonin herself wasn't trimmed up very much, and when I opened up the enclosure, she got out and flew off.
And was it OK?
No.
No.
No, she flew off, and she disappeared for 7 days. She was eventually found in Greenwich on the Royal Observatory.
Astronomy.
Yeah. And did she come back then? Did you take her back?
Well, she did eventually. She was caught by a member of the public and eventually returned back to the Tower of London under an ASBO. And that's where she spent the rest of her life.
Is it true that ravens play kaplunk?
Yes. But not with plastic straws. I use spaghetti straws because it's obviously better for them.
Yeah.
And in fact, Moonin was very, very good at it. It would take her about 45 seconds or so to get the mouse out with going around and pulling out all the spaghetti.
And did you use a real mouse?
Yes, I did, yes.
OK, moving on.
With very small pants.
Very small pants.
Because they're ravens, there are crows, and what's the other one?
Rooks.
Rooks, yes. And I don't know how to tell the difference between them.
Well, they're different species, really. A raven happens to be about twice the size of a crow, so it's like the daddy of them all the birds, really, and the most intelligent.
They have excellent memories, do they not? Is that right?
They do. They remember for life, yes, for good and bad reasons as well. Some of them like me, some of them like Moonin, who I chased around Greenwich, didn't.
Now, talked about having a very good memory. So here's the thing. You were supposed to be on the show before we had lockdown.
I was.
And you were supposed to be here on your wedding anniversary.
I was.
So we were very excited about this. And you've got your wife, Jasmine, with you. Hello, Jazz. Welcome to the show. How many years is it?
32.
Wow, that's fantastic. So anyway, because you were coming in on your wedding anniversary and you were both going to be here, we thought we'd get you a cake. So we're now here, finally doing this show. 5 months later, we found the cake. It was still backstage.
Delicious.
The cake, yum, the yum. Cake is there, shaped like your hat. It was a light sponge. We're going to get Tom to decide later on.
But I'll judge it, yes. I feel like it might be quite a heavy sponge now. I think the ravens might need it soaked in blood.
But thank you both very much for coming in. How fantastic.
Absolute pleasure. Thank you for having us.
Lovely. Raven George was dismissed for being stark raven mad. Mm. Now, what's the most reliable way to recognise a rattlesnake?
Ooh.
Go for it, Ed.
It's rattle.
Yay! No, why not?
They're all the same.
No, no, they're not all the same. Not all rattlesnakes rattle. Ooh. Is the problem.
Wouldn't that be annoying if you were a rattlesnake and you didn't?
One thing.
None of the other rattlesnakes would hang out with them.
No, we'd just be embarrassed, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
The Santa Catalina rattlesnake. It's Santa Catalina's an island off the coast of Southern California. It doesn't have a rattle at all. And nobody knows why. Maybe because it lives on an island where there aren't any large hoofed mammals. There's very few humans that might stumble. It basically doesn't need one.
So what makes it a rattlesnake? Yeah. It's just a snake.
No, you can tell the rattlesnake by its head, by its triangular head and its, you know, slitty eyes and so on. It just doesn't have this particular thing. Let's have a quick look at one that does have a rattle. That's what the rattle sounds like. So this is obviously not it living in Santa Catalina.
It's quite distinctive. You'd run away from that.
You would, yeah.
I wouldn't like that.
So the other possibility is, if it doesn't have a rattle, is that it's a baby rattlesnake.
Oh.
Yes, they're born with venom but without the rattle. So the bit that we saw there is a segment of, again, keratin. And those grow bit by bit. It sheds its skin when it's young every few weeks, and then each time a new segment of this keratin is added, and the snake needs at least two or three of those, if you imagine, in order to make that distinct rattling sound. And it comes from those keratin segments knocking against each other. So
weird, isn't it? Because if you're a human and you've got a rattle, you're definitely a baby.
Yes, I know.
Opposite.
And also an adult could lose the rattle through injury or through, you know, just old age, bloody annoying.
Upsetting for them.
But if you have a look at the one coming towards you, you can see that it's distinctive even without the rattle. You can see the triangular head and it's got these... yeah, I mean, it's slightly creepy, isn't it? Yeah. Oh, you don't like it, Tom?
No, I do have a pathological fear of all snakes. So it's no big deal that there's a massive one on the screen, but I just might not look up if that's all right.
Tom, it's gone. So, Tom, it's
no,
gone.
It's don't worry, it's fine. It's fine now. Tom, you're all right, Tom.
Tom, you're fine.
Yeah, just look up now.
No, oh, horrible. There's not one coming in, though, is it? It's not like, oh, and we've got one here now.
It's one we made earlier.
Yeah, so I will run all the way home.
Yeah. And now the keeper of rattlesnakes. If you are bitten by a snake, what should you do?
Oh, I'd just die. I would just die.
No, you probably wouldn't, darling.
Really? Would I not?
You probably not. No. In the United States, about 9,000 people a year are bitten by a snake and about 5 die. So statistically...
You're supposed to...
Wee on it.
Yeah, you get someone to wee on it.
Are you confusing jellyfish?
Fred, quickly.
I just think it's always worth a go.
Stung by anything, wee on it.
Have a quick wee on it.
You get a cowboy from a film to suck out the venom.
Oh, is that what it was?
Yeah.
Oh, we get those two muddled. Yeah. Do you wee on it or do you suck out the venom?
Yes, I know. Just standing there having a debate with yourself, trying to work it out.
Just try it all. Have a wee, have a suck. Yeah. Why not?
Excuse me, cowboy. Would you mind having a wee or a suck? I've been bitten by a snake. That's not a chat up.
We'll get you to do the voiceover.
Yeah, at this point, the large, handsome cowboy. call an ambulance, you fools.
In America, no thanks, I can't afford that. Just suck it.
stay calm, basically. You don't want to raise your heart rate.
Stay calm, you're dying.
Yeah, you've got about 12 hours to 18 hours before it turns too serious. You've got time to go. And the main thing is, if it's on a limb, apply some pressure to the bite. You don't want it spreading.
It's a tourniquet.
You certainly don't want to suck it, then, because you're going to get it in your mouth. You might have a cut in your mouth and die that way. I think that's a terrible
idea.
Wouldn't
that be terrible?
Now, why did the Japanese import so many raccoons?
Oh, thank God, we're talking about something else that I can look up.
Yeah. You're all right with raccoons?
No.
I don't know anything about it. But it used to be whether the horse was from good stock, so whether the parents or the siblings had won lots and lots of races. But in fact, they did some analysis. There's a man called Jeff Sedder. He's a racehorse analyst. So he collected lots of data about, from young racehorses and about how many races they had won. And the size of the left ventricle was the most telling physical trait. So the left ventricle is obviously the bit that pumps oxygen back out. They are unbelievably destructive and vicious.
Oh, aren't they quite violent? They're
quite vicious, yes. But by then, over 1,500 raccoons a year had been brought into Japan until they eventually banned them. And they're not suited to domestic life at all. And they released them into the wild in droves and they're now complete pests. Yeah. About 80% of all temples in Japan have suffered raccoon-related damage.
The clue was there when he was called Rascal.
Ah, yes. I don't know how that translates in Japanese.
Maybe it's adorable.
Cute. The Japanese name for them is... Areguma, which means washing bear, and it's thought that they wash their food because they so often dip it in water and roll it around in these incredibly dexterous hands. So they have an incredible sense of touch. And 2/3 of their sensory data comes from touch. And water is thought to help this tactile ability to retrieve the information that they're holding. Why do you think they have a mask? Why do you think they have that thing around the eyes?
Coronavirus.
Protect them. Yeah.
They have it on public transport.
Yeah.
And
they take
it off when they get when they're just walking along.
So responsible.
Yeah. They knew about it before we did.
Yeah.
But it's on their eyes rather than.
Yeah. They could have got it wrong.
Yeah.
But that's why they're always washing their hands. They're very.
Got in and out. Yeah. Burrowed.
It's one way.
Any thoughts? No. Dark mask around the eyes?
Something camouflagey about it.
Well, we're not really sure, but it may just reduce glare.
Well, they do that. The American footballers do that, don't they? They put dark
black
under there and it reduces the glare from the...
I thought it just looked mean.
Yeah, I thought it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it has gone a bit war-paint. But that was the original idea.
The Japanese do have a native population of raccoon dogs, which are totally unrelated to raccoons, despite their appearance, and they call them tanuki. So the one on the right is a raccoon dog and the one on the left is a raccoon. They are not in any way related. They're very important in Japanese mythology, so sometimes outside shops you see statues of raccoon dogs and they... Here are your huge testicles, OK? Not your... Sorry. Yeah. I don't know why.
I knew there was a reason I'd been booked for this.
Here are your huge testicles.
Who ordered the huge testicle?
What I meant was huge testicles we talked about on horses.
I can't sit comfortably anymore.
I know. So these statues outside shops sport huge testicles and. There we are.
Unmistakably.
Yeah, there I am.
There's a children's song, and the song goes, I mean, I'm translating roughly here. Tan tan, the tanuki's testicles ring. The wind has stopped blowing, but still they swing, swing. I mean, what child in the world doesn't want to
love that? I know. Still, love that lovely song.
Even with no breeze at all.
Keep on
swinging. In the wind. Those testicles are all the better for the fact they move when there's no wind.
He doesn't look well, does he? He doesn't look well at all.
Fist constantly work. Horrified by the size of his own testicles.
Or just exhausted from dragging.
Right, moving on. Name a rock singer who doesn't have a scrotum. Do you like the width and variety of the questions I'm asking?
I mean, when I said about the balls earlier on the horse, everyone was like, no, don't be so disgusting. Why are you obsessed with talking about scrotums? Every question.
It's just a reoccurring theme. You know
what are we going to do next year when it's the S series? We're going to have no scrotum.
No scrotum. You'll have run out of scrotums.
Name a rock singer who doesn't have a scrotum.
Well, so Avril Lavigne, Pink.
Yes, darling. Yes. Quite no, right. Please. No boy comes up with this. Debbie Harry, yes. Janis Joplin, Stevie Nicks.
It does sound like an interview question from like 1960s Q magazine. Name one rock singer without a scrotum. Go on.
It isn't an actual rock singer, although it kind of is. It's a creature called the rock hyrax, also known as the rock rabbit. It's found in Africa and in the Middle East. So the male does not have a scrotum. It keeps its testes in its abdomen. What it does have is the most fascinating system of communication, which is communicating through singing.
I'm not surprised if it's balls. It must be very high-pitched.
It's got about 30 syllables that it can do, wails and chucks and snorts and squeaks and tweets, and it turns it into a song that can last several minutes. And it's a bit like birdsong. It's a sort of form of self-advertising. So you can tell about its size and its age, its social status, even its hormonal state, that kind of thing. Mm. So we have a rock hyrax singing. Please do not think, as soon as you've heard this, you're going to rush out and get the album. It's just on the edge of disappointing. I'm just going to put it out there. OK, let's have a listen.
Andy Kershaw would play that on the radio.
It's like something written.
Now
by...
a new one from the Rock Hyrax.
Andy looks so grumpy.
I was looking for something a bit more romantic.
A bit more swinging.
Yeah.
It's all to do with having its bollocks stuck in its tummy. That's nothing to do with singing or its social status.
I want a scrotum! It could also be to do with its childhood, I think, because baby hyraxes have to eat their parents' poo. Ooh. Which is in the
They don't have to, come
yes, on. Yes, they do have to, Danny. They don't have the necessary bacteria to digest plant stuff, so a bit like baby koalas, the solution is to eat the mother's feces.
There's got to be another solution.
Get it while it's hot. Eat that before it goes cold.
So, a hyrax is about this big.
And its poo is this big.
What would you guess their closest relative to be?
Meerkat.
Yeah, you would think that, but it's not.
Well, it's not their parents if they're making them do that.
It's upset you, hasn't it?
Yeah, not, it's just not on.
No.
I think they could just have a yoghurt or something.
Yeah. Something with friendly bacteria.
Yeah.
That would be much more civilised.
The nearest relative to a hyrax. Pick an animal.
Mouse, rat, cat, dog, huge. Raccoon.
Huge.
Elephant.
Huge.
Elephant. Tiger. An elephant.
No, an elephant.
Yeah. Elephants and sea cows or manatees, they share a fairly recent common ancestor.
It's going to come
ancestor.
On a couple of years' time when science got it wrong.
Can you believe we ever thought these three things were related?
One geneticist, one wrong decimal place.
Geneticist.
One drunk geneticist.
Okay, that one. Yeah.
Can I just say that I think the elves were a little bit drunk because they said, I said, what was the common ancestor? And they did a picture for me. Just have a look at this. This is their view of what the common ancestor was. Elephants and hyraxes have certain characteristics which they share. So elephants don't have scrotums. They keep their testes near their abdominal cavity, near their
hips. I thought you were going to say in the suitcase or something.
Yeah. I thought they are meant to have their scrotums outside to keep the testes cooler. Because obviously the sperm doesn't produce properly.
Humans keep them outside for that reason, but elephants don't. Both have tusks. And instead of claws, they have the same flattened hoof-like nails that elephants do. So if you look at the feet of the hyraxes,
They look like they've got those slippers on.
Yes. And actually, you look at the ends of the flippers on the manatee or the dugong. It has a similar sort of look to it, doesn't it?
Yes.
And both female hyraxes and female elephants have a pair of teats near their armpits.
Beg your pardon.
It's not pleasant, is it?
Tuck in, kids. Help yourselves.
After you've had your shit.
Eat your shit first.
Then you can have milk.
Now it's time for the relentless rat race that is general ignorance, so fingers on buzzers, please. Ooh. What does Alan's swamp monkey use its tail for?
I'm not answering.
Well, that would be
dangling
good instead of the steps.
Dangling
that
from...
No, so it can't swing from trees or dangle from trees. Why not?
It's a fish.
It's a picture of it right in front of
it's
you.
It's in the water. Could be a fish. Could be even like a fish.
Yeah, the other one was like an elephant. I mean, why is that not a fish?
Yes. No, its tail is not prehensile. It's not able to grasp anything, so the tail would need to be prehensile if you're going to swing through a tree. So there are different monkeys. There are old world monkeys and new world monkeys, and the swamp monkey is an old world monkey, so native to Africa and Asia, and the new world monkeys are in the Americas. Most old world monkeys do have tails, but the tail is not prehensile. It's mainly for balance. So only new world monkeys, the ones from the Americas, have prehensile tails, and those can grab things and swing through the trees. In fact, we can have a look at a new world monkey. There we are. Look at that. It's astonishing, isn't it?
Yeah.
So monkeys from the Americas can do that, but African monkeys can't do that.
No, they don't have that ability with the tail to grab things. There are lots of creatures that do have prehensile tails.
Why?
So
why?
Why not give them that gift? I don't know.
They can't hang from the... I could have sworn I've seen them doing that.
You think it's a conspiracy?
I'm trying to think of the monkeys in London Zoo.
Well, they're neither here nor there.
They're in London.
They're London monkeys, right?
They're the London monkeys.
They're big city monkeys.
Yeah. Very chill.
They've got controlled parking zones.
There are lots of creatures with prehensile tails. There's the seahorses and anteaters, harvest mice, a tree pangolin. And there are also creatures with extraordinary things. So creatures with prehensile lips, rhinos have that. Harvest mice have the prehensile tail. Cats have prehensile claws. So they can grab and grasp things. The giraffe, if you have a look, has got a prehensile tongue. Extraordinary, and I'm not going to look at Ed as I say this. Tapirs have prehensile penises.
Yes, I knew someone was going to have them.
Me too.
No way. No way. With all the evolution that's gone on, someone was going to get one.
As soon as we finish here, I'm going to swing home.
What do they do with it?
Yeah, why did that make them survive?
So much better when you're watching the telly and you can't reach the stand.
Before the remote was invented.
It keeps them
Put the
coupled.
Nachos a bit nearer.
It keeps them coupled.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like barbs on foxes.
Yes, or the pig, which has a corkscrew penis. I know.
Yeah, you have to get one pig and then spin the other pig in.
I think even worse than that, well, for me anyway, the leaf beetle larvae, they have prehensile anuses, OK? It's like a sort of anal turret, and what they can do, they can build shields out of poo on their backs. And they place each piece of poo on their backs, and it becomes this sort of growing structure. And they can even move it slightly.
I'm just pleased for them that they don't know that's weird.
Yeah.
They had any sort of consciousness that they were shitting on their own backs, and that was nobody else was doing that.
Yeah.
I've got an anal turret. Why? I could have had a prehensile cock. I could have had massive bollocks like Ed Gamble.
Right, moving on. What should you call this if you are in Wales? Yes.
Rabbit.
Cheese on toast.
Yeah.
No, so it's been around since the 1500s. But the idea of calling it Welsh rabbit comes in 1785. It's a corruption of Welsh rabbit, which you find much earlier. You find that in 1725. So, according to Fowler's English Usage in 1926, Welsh rabbit is amusing and right, Welsh rarebit is stupid and wrong. I like a dictionary that just tells you straight out how things are.
Why have you put up a picture of the moon?
Yes, that's a large picture of the moon. But it's possible they were making a joke at the Welsh's expense, which is mean, isn't it?
Oh, that is.
Oh, so I've been asking for Welsh rarebit and it turns out I've been offensive, right?
Offensive, yes. Yeah. So to say Welsh in the Middle Ages was a slur, it sort of meant fake or poor or foreign. And there were lots of stereotypical jokes about the Welsh love of cheese. Right. Speaking of rabbits, let's go back to the moon. Can you name a star that is the same size as the new moon?
A star that is the same
size as the new moon? It's a slightly trick question.
Yes. Well, the stars are massive.
OK. At the time of recording, the planet Earth has acquired a new moon. It's a tiny asteroid, which we think has been circling the Earth for about 3 years. It's known as 2020 CD3, and it's somewhere between 1.9 metres and 3.5 metres in diameter, so it's about the same size as Richard Osman. This
object.
That's our star. That's our star that I
Good idea
say.
For what to do with Richard Osman.
A star that is the same size as the new moon. Has this not made kind of space news, this...
I think one of the challenges, what do you define as a moon?
Ah, OK. We've had lots of things on this show.
We've had so many moons,
yes.
Honestly.
How many moons, right, how many moons would you say the Earth has? And we have variously said there are two, which include Cruinia, a co-orbital body of the sun.
I remember Rich Hall sitting in that very chair saying, it's called the moon!
We've had many moons as an answer because of the small asteroids, and we've had no moons at all because, in fact, the moon and the other twin planets.
Yeah, because the moon is so large, it could be sort of like a binary system, not actually sort of seen as a separate...
Right, so what would you say if you were to ask the question, how many moons would you say the Earth has, what would your answer be?
As a self-certified lunatic, I'll say there's only one moon. And it's the best.
Boom!
I'm with that. Don't you vote for that? What do you think, Ed?
Yeah, one moon.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't want to worry about
it. I know. One moon.
You can call anything a moon because there's no sort of a cutoff on the size of a moon. As astronomers, we're a bit mamby-pamby, really. We only recently defined planets. I mean,
yes, because poor Pluto lost out.
Yes, but see, that's it. Yeah. So Pluto was a planet for ages, and then it's, sorry, mate. Yeah. Well, a dwarf planet.
Yeah.
Is that because it's just gases?
No, it's actually a solid rock.
Oh, but it's not big enough.
It's actually smaller than our moon.
Oh, really?
Yes.
It's probably the size of Wales. That's what people say, isn't it?
Yeah, everything's the size of Wales. Especially Wales.
So there's a suggestion from the elves, which I think you'll like, Alan, that you get 20 restorative points to make up for all the previous moon questions that you've suffered. Now we've had an expert tell us there's just the one.
Well, there's an opening offer. I'd like to go back and...
Oh, right. Right. Thanks to Maggie, we finally know how many moons the Earth has, at least till we move the goalposts again. All of which lunar lunacy brings us to the hair-raising business of the scores. So, over the moon in first place with -5, it's Maggie! In second place with -9, Tom! In third, even following the restorative points, you've got -16, Alan. I know. And in last place, not a happy bunny at all, I would imagine. No. With -17, it's Ed. Yeah. So, my thanks to Maggie, Ed, Tom and Alan, and I leave you with this quote from the High Times Encyclopedia of Recreational Drugs. A drug is a substance that, when injected into a rat, produces a scientific paper. Good night. Thank you.